four eminent speakers who are going to speak to us on this subject. First will be current dengue situation in Sri Lanka and strategies for the future by Dr. Hasita Tissera, who is consultant epidemiologist at the Epidemiology Ministry of Health. He was actually in charge of the dengue control unit for a long, long time. So today he's the most experienced person on control of dengue in this country. May I call Hasita to speak to us.
Thank you, sir, for that generous introduction. Let me thank the president and the council of the Sri Lanka Medical Association and the Committee on Communicable Diseases for timely deciding to do a seminar on dengue. So the theme of the seminar is control of dengue in Sri Lanka. Are we on the correct path? But what I'm going to talk about is mainly the current situation and strategies for the future. I'll try to briefly summarize them. I'll touch on global situation, talk a little bit about the epidemiology, how it's been changing over the last decade or so. Strategies for the future, I'll mainly concentrate on secondary prevention, which is early diagnosis and clinical management, which is really relevant to this audience. Although I've been doing control activities, I will not touch on the primary prevention except for primary prevention in terms of future vaccine introduction. So this is going to be my talk. Dengue has, over the last 60 years, emerged as a global public health emergency, or sort of. If you look at the Americas as well as many parts of Asia, there are so many countries reporting calamities due to dengue. Over the last 60 years, what was known as 10 countries as endemic in the 60s have become 124 countries by 2018. The number of symptomatic cases reported in 2018 is estimated to be 100 million patients globally. If you look at the Philippines, by yesterday, they have 200,000 cases reported for this year and 900 deaths calculated as 0.5 case fatality rate. So that's quite high. And so are other countries and regions. In the Americas, 2 million cases were reported so far. And this is just an example of a famous person in New Zealand who had to go to Mexico and die of dengue. So that also happens on and off. Malaysia has said they have doubled the number of deaths this year compared to last year. So this is the disease that we are talking about. So in terms of epidemiology, we have seen a dramatic change in the epidemiology of the human, the virus, the vector behavior, and the environment in the last 10 years, resulting in this catastrophic situation or the crisis, as the chairperson just mentioned, that we are in for. I just try to give you a few examples so that it will put things in perspective. There's a clear shift in the age from childhood, being a childhood disease in the last 20 years, to being a disease of all ages. There's a clear shift in both number of cases being reported among children as well as adults. And it has also been observed among deaths. We have more deaths among adults than among children as far as Sri Lanka is concerned. If you look at the virus, you know, there are four serotypes, and there is always a predominant virus that is causing epidemics of dengue. And we've seen this in many countries. I'll give you two examples. One is from Cuba. In 1997, where Cuba had dengue 1, which was the predominant virus, was replaced by a novel dengue 2 from Asia. And that had a huge impact on the Cuban society, causing large epidemic. And in even Sri Lanka, over the last 10 years, we've seen the change in the virus has resulted in a major symptomatic caseload reported compared to the previous years. And the vector, the survival of the vector and the longevity of the vector or the mosquito, which is the most kind of adapted vector in the into the environment is another matter that we need to really understand. With human and the movements of goods from area to area, from region to region, even within countries, has caused the vector behavior to change into adapting into the environmental conditions better. And in fact, it's an urban disease by and large. The changes we have seen in urban areas over the last 10 years is also something that we have to take note of, particularly the construction of larger spaces, man-made spaces, because this mosquito that is incriminated is an indoor biter and a day biter. So without understanding the biodynamics of this mosquito, it's very difficult to find a lasting solution to a problem like this. Even Singapore has had more than 10,000 cases reported this year. Singapore has the best possible control program that we know of as of today. So in 2009, we had a major calamity, of course, more serious than what it is today. We had 35,000 cases and 350 deaths, creating a case fatality rate of 1%. That means out of every 100 patients who were symptomatic, who came to hospital, one person died. And then at that time, what was known by and large was that dengue causes bleeding. The predominant cause of dengue hemorrhagic fever was thought as bleeding, because before that we knew about dengue, but after 1990, we started seeing a substantial number of patients dying of bleeding due to DHF. That's what we thought. So we thought DHF was the one that was causing all these problems, and we were trying to give symptomatic management for bleeding. But in 2009, when we had this large number of deaths, we realized that there is a different pathophysiological dynamic to dengue from what we thought it was. And at that time, if you look at DHF, DHF was predominant in younger age groups. The model age was towards a younger age cohorts, and the mean was around 15 years. Younger people were getting dengue at that time in 2009. So with time, we realized that there were identifiable primary causes of death due to dengue. By understanding the disease, we realized that these were preventable deaths most of the time. There were deaths due to prolonged shock, because extravasation of fluids into serosal spaces was the main hallmark of dengue. And with that, certain other conditions appear, which is also, there is also bleeding, and then organ failure, resulting in multi-organ dysfunction and deaths. We didn't know how to give fluids, with all due respect to all the people who were managing dengue. We didn't know much about fluid management. And then we were causing pulmonary edema, and some were dying due to extra fluid in the system, because this whole phenomenon was transient. And of course, some people were dying due to both of these reasons put together. So we realized the primary causes of death. There were multiple other causes, but these were the main causes that people died of. So with that background, we started looking into these problems in depth in terms of early diagnosis and trying to come up with a mechanism to manage the patients better. And we realized there were certain pitfalls. So this knowledge is from our clinical reviews, by going to hospitals and identifying patients, doing death audits. We have looked at almost all the deaths that have occurred in the last decade. And also, in fact, we have gone to doing pathological postmortems as well. So this knowledge is not just out of the blues. It's due to some scientific assessment that has been done over the last 10 years. So by looking at these pitfalls, we realize some of these pitfalls continue to date. So the deaths or difficulties, difficult situations that we face are due to some of these problems continuing to date. So some of the pitfalls in diagnosis, if I go through in very briefly, fewer patients, we don't suspect dengue sometimes, but it is time that we consider dengue as a possible differential diagnosis, or for that matter, the first differential diagnosis when you are confronted with the fever patient. So there is delay in diagnosing DHF also. We don't seem to appreciate the importance of the full blood count, particularly the white cell count, the platelet count, and the hematocrit in those patients. Sometimes we tend to over rely on the rapid diagnostic test. If the test is negative, we say it is not dengue and something else. We are trying to look for other etiological causes when the test is negative, which is not the case in most of the time. Sometimes the test is negative because of the dynamic nature of the disease, not because it's a different etiology. And anyway, the rapid diagnostic test cannot differentiate dengue hemorrhagic fever from dengue fever. Only the full blood count or the CBC, or for that matter, the hematocrit can do that. And then we misjudge leaking. We don't look at leaking as a possible phenomenon on dengue and allow the patient to go into shock. So what is presented to us sometimes is shock. And they don't have the classical dengue features when they come in shock. So that's another problem that we are confronted with. Some patients come with other features and not pertaining to dengue when they come to us. So that's another difficult situation. And dengue shock is not like other shocks, unfortunately. In other shocks, the patients don't have, blood pressure and pulse is not there. Whereas in dengue shocks, the systolic blood pressure is normal. The diastolic blood pressure increases and the pulse pressure narrows. So we don't consider this as shock in many of other etiologies. But this is dengue shock. If the blood pressure is 110 by 90 or 100 by 80, your pulse pressure is 20. Pulse pressure 20 is shock in dengue, compensated shock, not waiting till hypertension to occur is a problem. We don't appreciate this to be a shock, but this is dengue shock for you. And we don't recognize concealed bleeding because patients have higher amount of hematocrit value. Sometimes they may be going into repeated shocks of this nature, but we are waiting for hypotension to occur and then we come up with bleeding. And they may be having concealed bleeding. We don't appreciate because anyway, your hematocrit is still high. So that's another pitfall that we have seen. And then we don't seem to be recognizing some very sort of common features of bleeding, peptic ulcers and menstruation. We seem to overlook that, but that can cause significant amount of bleeding and death. So these are some of the diagnostic issues that we have seen. In terms of management, I'm not a clinician, but I'm looking at it from an epidemiological point of view. I must caution you because I'm not a practicing clinician. We seem to be continuing to use inappropriately antipyretics. We try to bring down fever without thinking about viremia. Viremia equals, febrile period. However much you try to bring down viremia, fever, it doesn't come down because the viremia is already still there in the patient. So antipyretics don't seem to bring down the fever to nadi. It only gives partial relief. So we should understand that. We try to give various other drugs, trying to bring down fever and making the patient feel better. Especially that can cause hemorrhage, hepatic dysfunction, and also today's context causes false sense of well-being. If you give steroids to a fever patients, they feel better and they can even go back to work, but they go into shock. So that's what we see today. Unnecessary IV fluids is not very common in Sri Lanka, but we still see situations where we give IV fluids during the febrile phase to DF patients who are not leaking. That's another important thing that we should avoid. Then we still continue to say, drink as much as you can. Drinking early plain water doesn't help you from going into shock when it is leaking. So that should be something that we have to change. We should not allow the patients to drink too much. They should drink only adequately, but avoid plain water, because plain water, when they start leaking, leaks very fast. That's another important thing. Failure to monitor and then resulting in giving too much fluid. We don't monitor, we put 500 ml of saline and think that by tomorrow the patient will be better. That doesn't happen in dengue. So that's another pitfall in terms of management. And then we don't stop when the leaking is over. The extravasated fluid is coming back to the intravascular compartment, but we continue to give IV fluids from outside. So we are also giving fluid. Fluid is coming back. We overload the patient, and patient goes into pulmonary edema and consequences. So that's giving too much fluid and for too long is a major concern. And then bleeding, I told you about. And then we have to always keep this in mind: acidosis, bleeding, calcium leaks in with the fluids, and then patients don't eat, so they are hypoglycemic. ABCS is something that we don't consider in all our patients coming in shock. If a patient comes in shock, always think of ABCS: acidosis, bleeding, calcium is low, and they are hypoglycemic. You have to correct the hypoglycemia. These are important dimensions when you are managing a patient coming in shock, wherever it is. So if you look at the last decade, our prevalence has gone up to about 30 to 40,000 cases annually. So not a joke. It's a large number. And then, every 3 to 5 years, we get a major epidemic. So these epidemics are related to changes in the virus. Dengue 1, which was predominant from 2009, was replaced by Dengue 2 in 2017. And then now we see Dengue 3 coming up. My colleague will talk about that more. I won't touch on that. But the good thing is that our case fatal rate, which was 1%, has come down to almost 0.1%. So nothing, all is not bad. We are doing much better than we were. From a case fatality of 1%, we have come down to nearly 0.1%, which means that for 1,000 patients reported, less than one is dying as of today. So this is the way for future. In 2009, we had 35,000 cases, 340 deaths. The morbidity rate was 175 per 100,000 population. That's the incidence. If you look at the case fatality rate, our case fatality rate was 1%. So we had a objective of bringing down our morbidity rate to less than 100 per 100,000. So that means 20,000 cases for 20 million population. So we are at the moment double that, right? Because we have 50,000 cases. And then overall case fatality rate has come down to 0.1% by 2018. But now we have to start looking at our DHF case fatality rate. That is where we have to now concentrate on. For units, hospitals, wherever we manage our patients, our case fatality rate for dengue hemorrhagic fever should be less than 1%. So we still are very proud of our case fatality rate coming down to less than around 0.1%, but we still have to work harder to achieve this. We have not come to that level. So why are we worried? If you look at now, over the last century, decade, dengue has changed the epidemiology, as I told you. 75% adults, 25% children. So in terms of overall cases, more adults than children. In terms of dengue fever and dengue hemorrhagic fever, mean is now shifting to the right for both DF and DHF. So we have DHF among adults as well. DHF was predominantly among children. Now we have DHF equal proportions in adults. So now it's a little challenge because Anand will touch on that more. Mean age is 28 years. Mean age for DF was the same. So now we can't differentiate unless we look for it, because all patients look the same. So that's another epidemiological change. If you look at the deaths over the last 5 years, we are happy that the proportion of deaths have come down, but I am not happy with the number of deaths. In terms of epidemic years, we have had a higher number of deaths. So we should not be complacent that our case fatality has come down to 0.1%, because all in all, things seem to be looking good, because your denominator is the total number of cases that are reported. That's how you calculate the case fatality rate. But if you look at the total number of deaths, 70% of deaths are from 15 to 60 years, 70%. So the majority of them don't have comorbidities also. So they are healthy people who are working, people who contribute to the economy, they are dying due to dengue. So that's something that we have to take note of. And in terms of knowledge, we have enough knowledge. We have guidelines that were developed for management of children, management of adults. This year we developed in conjunction with the SLMA's contribution, we were able to publish the national guidelines on pregnancy. We have guidelines for nurses. And if you are looking for international guidelines, please refer to only this document, because if you Google, there'll be 100 guidelines coming to you, and they'll be giving 100 different ways of managing patients. So don't try to adapt those guidelines without referring to these books, because these books were developed by us. with our own knowledge. A little bit about where we are in terms of control. So we have the healthy community. We have 3-4 minutes, I suppose.
Yeah, please.
Yeah. So in terms of community, we have healthy people. This is the infected people. All of us probably belong into this category. 75% asymptomatic, 25% symptomatic. And infected people contribute to infecting the mosquitoes. So we have to bring down the uninfected mosquito population. That is vector control for you. At the same time, infected mosquitoes bite healthy people. And we have to knock down or prevent people from getting bitten by these mosquitoes, infected mosquitoes. So those are the two challenges. Getting people infected, not to be bitten by uninfected mosquitoes, not allowing infected mosquitoes to bite humans, by controlling, by preventing the mosquito biting healthy people, whichever way we could. So it's not easy. Although I try to put it in this, when you do it on long term, it's not very easy to do this, because bringing down these mosquitoes is not easy. Knowing where the mosquitoes are already infected is not easy. Telling people how to control, prevent mosquito bite is not easy. Foreigners coming here, preventing mosquito bites because they apply repellents during the time they spend in tropical areas is not a problem. But doing day in, day out for communities who have lived in this community is not easy. So it has to be thought in that sense. So last 2017, we looked at the mosquito population. We looked at 300,000 houses. 15% of the houses were positive. Of them, 38% of breeding were discarded containers. In Western province, 50% of discarded containers were positive for Aedes aegypti, the notorious mosquito, the bad one, which is the urban mosquito. So, and it is all over the country. It is ubiquitous. We have the problem in all the regions. It's no more urban, no more rural kind of thing. It's there even in Uwa. If you go to Uwa, 41% of discarded containers breed dengue mosquitoes. So it's a huge problem. It's not only health that can do a change to this kind of situation. It has to be multidisciplinary. And if you don't do that change, we are always talking about the disease when it is raining. We like to talk about the disease more. I mean, I'm not blaming SLMA for having it when it's raining, but we always tend to talk about this disease when it's raining. So when you do that during the rain time, you can do only a little, because already the mosquito population is increased and this is the human epidemic. But what I'm trying to tell you is you have to start working even so it has to be constant, because we are endemic now. Even before rain, if you do some work, you can reduce this is rapid response, reducing the transmission of mosquitoes. And then your major epidemic can be smaller. So that is our challenge, and that is where we have to strive in order to bring down the influence on humans by doing a constant job of work, not talk about dengue, particularly during the rainy season. Because it is relevant, I will talk a little bit about the dengue vaccine, because I think that's important. So where are we in terms of dengue vaccine? In 2015, there was a vaccine available where few countries decided to license it. Mexico was the first, Philippines, followed by Brazil. Total of 20 countries have registered the vaccine. And in two regions, vaccine is now available to be used for humans to prevent dengue. And in two countries, they decided to go first and introduce into the public health program. That means they decided to, I'll take the Philippines as an example because it's in the region. 1 million children were identified, and they wanted to give 3 doses of this vaccine to 1 million children between the ages of 9 and 10 in the schools. And that's what they did. Subsequently, when they did that, Sanofi Pasteur, the manufacturer of the vaccine, came up with a public notice saying that seronegative should not be vaccinated due to the increased risk of severe disease among them. So if you are not exposed to the wild virus before, if you vaccinate them, that's your first infection. So natural infection caused by the virus for the second time can cause severe disease. That's what it simply means. So WHO went back on their word and gave a different position paper. They said pre-vaccination screening is the way to go forward. And only those who are identified to be positive, exposed to the natural virus or the wild virus before, should be allowed to take the vaccine. So this is what is what has transpired over the last 3 years. So what did we do? We were offered the vaccine in 2016, and 2017, I told you that we had a major epidemic. So we asked to review the vaccine and give a decision as to what we should do. But I must congratulate Sri Lanka for allowing the scientists to take that decision. And we went through the WHO position paper that was available at that time in terms of immunogenicity, efficacy, and safety. We looked at the WHO position that was available to us, which was the scientific document that was given to us with the dossier that was submitted by the manufacturer. There was no WHO pre-qualification at that time. And immunogenicity showed a difference between subjects who are seronegative between the viruses, the four viruses. They were not equal. Efficacy was different for those who were seropositive and seronegative. We saw that there was a difference. And safety was that the ones who were exposed to the vaccine when they were young for the phase 3 trial had a higher number of hospitalizations compared to the older ones. So these were observed by us in 2017. And then a committee was formed at the NMRA. Two members of the committee, in addition to me, are presenting today. We decided to wait for more evidence and not register the vaccine. Let's see what happened in Pakistan, in Philippines. So Philippines went ahead and registered the vaccine. In fact, they introduced the vaccine into the public health program and gave the vaccine to 830,000 children who were between 9 and 10. When Sanofi had the press release saying that those who are seronegative is going to have more severe disease, there was outrage, immediate outrage in Philippines. And then people came up saying that my child died of the vaccine. 9 and 10, whatever death that occurred to children who were vaccinated, they claimed that as the vaccine failure. There was a political turmoil because there was a change in the government. The regulators, former Secretary of Health, and some of the researchers were indicted. In fact, the key researcher who was responsible for the vaccine phase 3 trial, if found guilty, is going to go to jail for 48 years. She's being, she'll be convicted if found guilty. The case is going on. Public trust, there was collateral damage because of this. Public trust on vaccines were broken in terms of all vaccines. In fact, there was vaccine confidence that was tested subsequently, and then with previous information. 2015, they had confidence of 93% for all vaccines, plumped down to 32%. With collateral damage resulting in major outbreaks of measles killing hundreds of children in Philippines. So that's what we probably avoided, but this is something that we had to, take note of, because this was done because scientists decided to refrain from registering that vaccine at that point in time. So future, again, what is available, not my opinion. So if we decide to give the Sanofi vaccine, Denvaxia, they come say that if seroprevalence is more than 70% in that age cohort, we can consider giving it. However, they also say that in small print, because of the inability to have 100% sensitivity and specificity, provided that your sensitivity is 85% and your sensitivity is 85% and specificity is 95%, you can probably prevent 1,000 cases from getting dengue, but at the same time cause 8 children to have more severe disease. So by giving the vaccine, are we to cause harm to 8 children? I probably would not want to allow that to happen to my child. So that's where we are now. Even if you decide to register the vaccine and start giving it, even after testing, with the best available test, if you decide to give the vaccine, you are going to cause 7 to 8 children to have falsely identified as seropositive when they are actually seronegative. And they will have more severe disease subsequently if they're exposed to the wild virus. And Takeda vaccine, we are also one of the countries doing the phase 3 trial. So yellow fever is the backbone for Sanofi vaccine. Takeda has decided to go with dengue 2 as the backbone. We don't have the data as yet, but we are expecting phase 3 trial results to be available end of this year. And most talked about vaccine is NIH vaccine, where they are employing all 4 subunits of the dengue virus. And probably we'll have to make a call when we have more available data to talk about the vaccine in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tesseram. We will have the questions at the end of the session of the meeting. The next speaker will be Dr. Ananda Vijayvikrama. He is consultant physician at the National Institute of Infectious Diseases. He has been there for quite a long time, and he has large experience, a lot of experience on management of dengue, because today probably in Colombo, the NIID is the center of excellence for management of dengue. And they have had large number during the epidemic. I know they had 18,000 patients in 2017 at NIAID. So he has a lot of experience in the management of dengue patients. Anand.
Thank you very much, sir. And, first, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to share some of the experience we had on this. As Asita has shown, the incidence of dengue increased since 2009, where we had 35,000 cases, and it was gradually going up till 2017, where we had more than 180,000 cases. And as Asita showed, the mortality rate, which was 1%, mortality rate was 1% in 2009. So we had 350 deaths. So the ministry got worried. And the next year, the 6 of us were sent to Thailand for a training. Myself, Lakuma, actually 4 of them are pediatricians. And myself and Dr. Ms. Gunadhana were the physicians. And then once we came back, there were some, we realized that what we have been doing here was not very correct. So we changed, we made the fresh guidelines. I must say the Hasita was behind us, he was the driving force of making these guidelines, but all of the people who went for the training, and some, there were some others who went for this training later, all of them contributed. And with that, we were able to reduce this mortality rate. We changed up, basically we changed the management, and we were able to reduce the mortality rate to present near 0.1%. There were some major changes in the management. If I may list major ones, one was the regular monitoring of vital parameters, anticipating complications. Previously, we were monitoring these patients when they had complications or when their pressure drops also. But now we monitor them, anticipating complications, so that we can detect these complications early and treat these complications. And then we have been, we started using measuring hematocrit and using it to interpret the findings, and also to intervene based on the hematocrit and other parameters, which we haven't done before. And then the use of ultrasound to detect plasma leakage. And then we had fairly good understanding of plasma leakage, the dynamics of plasma leakage, and accordingly, we adjusted the fluid given to such patients rather than giving fluid boluses, which we have been doing previously. And then the use of colloids and the blood transfusions were major changes which happened after this training. And with that, as Hasita shown, the age groups involved were changed. And as he said, now more than from 2012, we have more than 70% of patients who are above 15 years of age. So this has been noticed in other countries also, or Bangladesh, Thailand, Indonesia, India, in those countries also, this has been noted. And with this, there had been changes or differences noted among the child and adult populations about the complications of dengue. Now, this study shows the plasma leakage and shock were more common and severe in children than adults, while bleeding and organ dysfunction are more frequent in adults. So similarly, in other countries also, the complications seems to be more in adults, especially bleeding. And So with that, the blood transfusion or when to transfuse blood and giving blood transfusion at the correct time became a major step in managing these patients. And as I said, from the dengue control unit, they distributed these microhematocrit machines to all the first to all the hospitals, then to most of the medical wards, and now most of our medical units are having this microhematocrit machine so that they can do hematocrit then and there, and they get quick results within 5 minutes. You get the result, and that can be used along with vital parameters to decide on the management. Ultrasound had been actually we were much late in introducing some of these changes. Ultrasound had been used when you look at literature, even in 1991, ultrasound had been used in dengue to detect plasma leakage. And these are some of the literatures shown in using ultrasound in dengue. And this one, a good study done in Thailand in 2007, which showed ultrasonography signs of plasma leakage were detectable before changes of hematocrit. So they advocate using ultrasound. However, we adopted it much later. We adopted all these changes much later. However, now a lot of units are using on-site ultrasound machine, using portable ultrasound examination, using portable ultrasound machines to detect plasma leakage. And together with measuring hematocrit and vital signs, we can detect these complications in most of these patients early. And we understood that the plasma leakage does not occur at a flat rate, but generally goes up. And the degree of plasma leakage varies from individual to individual. And if the leakage is little, nothing happens. Even if you don't do anything, nothing happens. Even if you do something wrong, still nothing happens. But if the leakage is more, then it can cause problems. It can lead to intravascular volume depletion, which can lead to narrowing of pulse pressure, shock, and organ damage, resulting organ damage. Unlike in other shocks, in dengue shock, the first organ to get damaged is the liver. And if that damage or the hypotension persists for a few hours, then there will be significant liver damage, which in turn will cause further bleeding due to disseminated intravascular coagulation. So the bleeding is one of the key problems in these patients. This lady was admitted to a hospital 2 years ago, 30-year-old lady with a POF 28 weeks who had diabetes, pregnancy induced. I was admitted with fever for 3 days duration, a body weight of 65 kilos. On the fourth day of the illness, she was detected by ultrasound, having plasma leakage. And she was shifted to the dengue HDU. And at the HDU, she was given 75 ml of fluid per hour. And she was monitored. Her urine output was adequate. So she was detected as having leakage at 10 o'clock. Probably this would have started about 18 hours before that time. With these findings. And next day morning, she was found to be in shock with severe acidosis. So she had significant leaking. The fluid was not replaced adequately. Unfortunately, because she was pregnant and because she was diabetic, her urine output was good. Probably she was monitored only by using the monitors, and she didn't have enough fluid. She went in shock and died. And when it was detected, it was too late. And bleeding is another problem. And the one on the left hand side showed the bleeding into areas where venipunctures were done. And the one on the right side, the picture on the right side is interesting. This of a 17-year-old boy who had dengue tested, who had fever at end of 24 hours or beginning of second day, they tested NS1, that was negative. Third day, he went for a rugger match. He was the captain of the under 17 rugger team in the school. So he went for a rugger match, had a fall, had a bruise on the elbow. And next day he was not feeling well. They did a blood count to find the platelet count of 60,000. So he was admitted, he was leaking, and he started bleeding into the bruise. We were very worried because he of the compartmental syndrome. He has so much of tense bleeding into that area. However, somehow we were able to sort of stop bleeding, and we had to give him blood, we had to give him fluid. Somehow he was survived without any surgical intervention, because doing any surgical intervention at this time would be again probably a disaster, because the bleeding tendency is so high. So the bleeding is another problem. As I mentioned, this 67-year-old diabetic patient was transferred to us from Jayawardenapura Hospital with a history of 7 days fever. He was at the end of the critical phase, but his hematocrit, when he came, he had significant amount of leaking. His hematocrit was 27. So we transfused him with blood, and the hematocrit increased slightly, again started dropping. So we had to give him about 3 units of blood, and we were not sure where he is bleeding. There was no visible bleeding. And the next day, when I was doing the round, he was complaining of difficulty in getting down from the bed, and he was keeping his knee flexed. So we thought there's some problem with the psoas muscle. We did a CT scan, and this, what we found, he has bled into the psoas muscle. And we had to make his hematocrit stable, we had to give him about 4 units of blood. So he had bled all that into this muscle. So muscle bleeding is one of the problem. And often this blood is not overt. So that is why we need to monitor these patients with the hemodynamic parameters and the hematocrit, and correlate the findings to detect, decide on giving blood. This previously healthy lady came with history of fever, dengue antigen was positive, she started leaking, and then we increased fluid, so he managed. And then the hematocrit dropped during that time, so we had to give her some blood, but again there was no place of bleeding. And then she was complaining of pain on the lower part of the middle of the abdomen, and there was a little swelling. We did ultrasound, they said there's thickened rectus muscle and queried bleeding, and this was continuing, and we had to give a couple of more bloods, and the pain was getting more and the swelling was getting more, and we did a CT scan to see that you can see the thickened rectus muscle because of bleeding. You can appreciate the degree of thickening, the normal muscle, the thickened muscle due to bleeding. And then the fever was continuing and the tenderness there was becoming more and more. We had to seek the help of surgeons, and finally we had to open her up and found large necrotic area in the rectus muscle, which had to be removed. And then she recovered with antibiotics and following the removal of the necrotic rectus muscle, which occurred as a result of bleeding into the muscle. So the precipitance of bleeding, as Hasis said, can be the intrinsic factors like the peptic ulcers or menstruation, even physical exertion, we think probably tend to precipitate bleeding, and IM injections, NSAIDs, and also steroids. Sorry, I haven't mentioned that here. And the prolonged shock, all these tend to precipitate bleeding. So therefore, we know there are some avoidable factors, but unfortunately, still, these are some of the things our patients got, the admitted patients got. Still, some of our people are using NSAIDs. This is another one. You can see all these are NSA. This is a very unfortunate situation. These patients brought this when they came. I thought of showing that so that it will. And now some people, there has been a GP from Maharagam who has given this kudumul also recently. So we recommend giving blood if there's over bleeding of about 200-300 milliliters. Or if there's a significant drop of hematocrit with unstable hemodynamic parameters, if the patient is in shock, even if the hematocrit is normal, we have to consider bleeding. And then when there's worsening metabolic acidosis and refractory shock, then we need to consider blood transfusion. Not this, all these patients will need blood, but we have to strongly consider and have a low threshold of giving blood if the patient is in shock with a small amount of fluid leakage shown in the ultrasound, because the shock is then more likely to be due to bleeding in addition to plasma leakage. And then if they have low or normal hematocrit with unstable hemodynamic parameters. Because generally, we expect hematocrit to go up if this instability is solely due to plasma leakage. If there's not enough rise in the hematocrit, then you have to suspect in addition to plasma leakage or without plasma leakage, the bleeding. This patient, a patient who was with us many years ago, she started leaking. We gave her fluid, then the hematocrit dropped, then she collapsed. I'll just go through fast forward. Then in spite of blood and fluid boluses, the patient was going into shock repeatedly. Hematocrit drops, we give her blood for about 4 or 5 hours, she is stable. So we had to give about 4 or 5 bloods. And then still she was not stable. So I didn't know what to do. Then finally I decided to tap the pleural fluid because she had a large pleural effusion. And this patient had to be ventilated. So it's not easy to do a pleural aspiration in a patient who is being ventilated. So we had to sit her up, hold by many people. And this, I was aspirating her pleural effusion. And this is what I got, 1,600 of blood aspirated. And in the midway of aspiration, my MO was telling that now he can feel the pulse. So most likely patient had a tension hemothorax causing impairment of the venous return. And then we had to put her, we had to give some more blood. Then later we were able to extubate her and we had to put IC tube because there was some more bleeding and then the patient recovered. So the pleural aspiration has a, we don't do it commonly. Okay, there can be occasional days where there's a tension hemothorax, so large effusions causing respiratory distress and interfering with ventilation, those who are on ventilation. These are only in very severe cases who need ICU care or if there's a suspicion of a pyothorax. Similarly, there can be incidence of acidic fluid aspiration, need of that, which may be more common in people with complications. If the patient is having tensositis interfering with ventilation, if the patient is having tensositis with reduced urine output, then the best thing is to insert a PD, peritoneal dialysis catheter, so that we can drain the fluid out, and if necessary, we can continue with the peritoneal dialysis using the same catheter. Before that, we recommend monitoring the measure bladder pressure. This is the sort of proper way of monitoring the bladder pressure, but we can do it simply by inserting about 100 ml, putting about 100 ml of normal saline into the catheter and making it, lifting it vertically and checking the height of the saline column. If it is more than 30, then there's definite indication, that's a definite indication to aspirate the acidic fluid. The unusual manifestations are the liver failure, myocarditis, encephalitis, and hemophagocytic syndrome. Liver failure generally occurs secondary to prolonged shock. And if that occurs secondary to prolonged shock, the prognosis is very poor. We have to give symptomatic management, correct clotting. And myocarditis is an uncommon thing. There are cases, but there should not be any change in the fluid management. We have seen problems causing due to restriction of fluid in patients who had myocarditis. Those patients went into hypovolemic shock and died, whereas they won't die of myocarditis. Encephalitis, again, a rare situation where the management will be symptomatic. On the other hand, hemophagocytic syndrome, though it is a rare condition, it needs to be diagnosed early and need early treatment because otherwise they can die of that. So unusual manifestations are
CAB6251 is blocking a gate and it's kindly removed. It's a white car. CAB6251. Thank you.
So unusual manifestations are unusual. We don't have to pay much attention to those things. Majority of the deaths or problems or the severe morbidity is due to prolonged shock, which is due to late presentations or inadequate fluid resuscitation. Still we get late presentations. I must say this year probably we see more patients coming late to hospitals than previous years. I don't know, patients have become complacent. And then the fluid overload can occur, though it is much less than earlier. The management has improved well, so the fluid overload is not seen or not seen much, or at least not causing problems. And but still, not suspecting bleeding and not transfusing blood at the correct time has caused problems. I think this, some of our deaths are due to this. So we have to have a, this is a bleeding disorder. We have to suspect bleeding. A lot of people have bleeding, whether it is significant or not is the question. So we have to suspect, have a high suspicion to detect bleeding early and treat these patients whenever it compromises the hemodynamics. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ananda. Dr. Lakrama Fernando is speaking now. He is talking, he is going to talk about what should we do to bring down case fatality rate of dengue further in the present epidemic. His consultant pediatrician and also is the initiator of the Clinical Management Dengue Center in Nigambo. He's the one, he's the founder. Thank you.
For inviting me to talk today. I'm actually just going to share my experience about dengue. I'm pediatrician at Nigambo Hospital. This is our new children's ward, which was a donation from a dengue patient whom I treated in 2017. We got a brand new pediatric complex with 100 beds. Two stories with foundation for five stories. And this is our Center for Clinical Management of Dengue and Dengue Hemorrhagic Fever. So I'm not going to tell a lot about success stories. I'm basically really trying to find out, as Hasita Ananda all showed, we are doing quite well compared to many countries. Our case fatality rate is very low. It's 0.1%, but still we are having some deaths. So we need to find out what are those and what can we do about them. This is a, this is one of Savitarana's this slide is made of his findings in 1997. I'm just trying to tell you that in 1989, I was an intern house officer in Colombo at Ward 1 Lady Regia Hospital. We had a major epidemic of dengue hemorrhagic fever, where we had just 203 patients and 20 deaths with a case fatality rate of 9%. It was mainly in Colombo. At the same year, Thailand had 74,391 cases with a case fatality rate of 0.39%. Now, Thailand had their first dengue in 1958, and we had our major dengue epidemic somewhere in 1989. Now, 30 years of dengue for us, we have got a case fatality rate of 0.1%. Of course, we are thankful to Thailand because we build on what they discovered. And if you see, they've already had for 74,000 cases at that time, 290 deaths. We have about 50,000 cases and 65 deaths today. So we are doing all right. This was the situation in 1989. Here we were 9%. The island was less than 1%. And in August 20th, I was told this figure may be wrong. I just got this from the dengue control unit. I was told that there are 41,300 cases and 65 deaths. Our case fatality rate right now is 0.15, more than 0.11 that was there last year. And 10 years ago, we had 35,000 cases and 346 deaths. We can just say that during the last 10 years, we've improved in this compared to what we have had. It appears that we have almost saved close to 300 patients that would have died if we did not have the change in 19, from 2010 onwards. Now 6 out of 7 patients who died of dengue in 2009 now survive, but it's still not enough. This is Hasita's slide. I got permission this morning to use it. If you just see the DFDHF ratio is what is showing. It was 6% in 2009. Now it is 20%. It's going up. If you see the other one, I'll show it better. This is the children versus adults, less than 15 years and more than 15 years. Looks like that there are more fatalities in the adults and children. I'm a pediatrician. I like to say that pediatricians are looking after the dengue better, but I know that it is the comorbidities and there are so many other things. Fine. This is that we have seen the case fatality of DHF was almost 10% in 2009. Now it is 1%. We have to make it even less for DHF. So DHF is on the rise. A lot more adults die than children, and case fatality is coming down. That's the simple story. In this, again, I know that I'm probably the only pediatrician here. I was telling that in 2015, that the 10 to 14 age group, there were 10% deaths, and it was 5% in 2017. The age range for admission to the children's ward changed in 2016, and now the 14 years are in the pediatric ward. So probably the adult wards are very busy, a lot of people, a lot of patients. Here the children with dengue are probably getting a slightly better attention. This is Hasita's slide for what he showed over decades, what has happened to the case fatality and the serotypes. But all what you need to realize is when the numbers increase, when you have a lot of patients, we find it difficult to cope. As a result, the case fatality goes up. So if you want to keep the case fatality rate down, number one, keep the cases numbers low. Because in 2016, 0.18 went up to 0.24. And the 2018, 0.19 has already gone up to 0.15. Because that downward trend is lost when the patient number increases. This is during 2017, at Nigambo looked after about 20,000 dengue patients during the 2019 epidemic. This is the male medical ward, not during visiting hours, the normal hours, because this has about 80 beds, 250 patients. We had 700 dengue patients on a given day in the two children's ward and the two medical wards. The female, one of the female medical wards, and there were 4 medical wards and 2 pediatric wards. This is the pediatric ward. Only DHF, only the leaking patients will get a bed. Others will have to be on the floor in 2017. Just because we have a brand new pediatric complex, we are better. But even in that, we have 2 patients in one bed now. We have about 40 patients of dengue in all the wards right now. This is the serotypes. Thanks to Janaki Abhinayak of MRI. How it happened, you can just see that type 2 has been predominant from about 2015. And you can see the green, the type 3 is just jutting out. It's going to be prominent. Now, when we had 2000, our serotypes, almost 92% of the 2017 epidemic was serotype 2. Probably when we had 200,000 cases, we probably had 10 times more asymptomatic infections. That is, we probably had 2 million cases of serotype 2 infections in 2017. And all those patients had cross immunity against all 4 other serotypes that lasted for maybe about 6 months, maximum for about 1.5 years. All that is over now. Now, we have about 2 million people who have got one infection, who can, when they get a second infection, they can get severe dengue if it is from a different serotype, because you can develop dengue 4 times during lifetime. For each serotype, you will have lifelong immunity. There will be cross immunity against all serotypes that will last for about 6 months to 18 months. And then when you are confronted with a different serotype, we are ideal in 2019, where we got 2000 type 2 immunity and new type 3 coming. This is what I sent. I checked some 63 samples for serotypes. What we saw was we have type 1 17%, type 2 26%, type 3 only in 41, and type 3 and 1 together. Now, when sometimes you can have you can get infected with two types of virus. One may be prominent. So when you add together, 50%, more than 50% of our cases now are type 3. Right. Now I will tell you not good stories or not success stories. I purposely did not bring. There are always very difficult patients who come, even worse than what I'm going to tell you, who have survived. But for some reason or the other, we had 7 dengue deaths. We had 20,000 patients in 2017 and 19 dengue deaths, and we had 7 deaths. I just thought, if we can go through these cases, each of these cases, and find out what exactly happened to this, and if we can stop this happening again, then we can bring down the case fatality. I'll tell the first 25-year-old young man. He died on admission. What happened to him? He got fever on day 1, went to the GP. The GP is one of our hospital doctors. He gave steroids as well as NSAIDs. He got almost 90 tablets of various things on fever. He was told to do a full blood count on day 3. But in day 2 days, fever disappeared with all these cocktails. He didn't have any fever. So the need to do full blood count did not arise by 3rd day. But 3rd day he was having abdominal pain. He suffered at home having abdominal pain. Then he got admitted to a nearby Akaragama hospital. He's a relatively person. He has a small car sale. He went to the Akaragama hospital and got admitted. What did they diagnose? They diagnosed gastritis. They kept him for almost 1 day, that day from morning till night. In the night, around 9 o'clock, they gave him a transfer form, said, ambulance එකක් නෑ අතේ අරගෙන ගිහිල්ලා නිකම් වල ඇඩ්මිට් වෙන්න ගැස්ට්‍රයිටිස් එක හොඳ වෙන්නේ නෑ. Nothing about fever, they all forgotten dengue can be a possibility. His wife was to deliver that day. That was priority for his family. He and his father came. He was not well. He was in the van. He got his father to admit the wife to Naloka hospital. Nigambo, around 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock. And he was in the van, thinking whether to go to hospital or wait there till, because the wife is there. But close to midnight, close to 1 o'clock, he was feeling quite unwell and the abdominal pain was increasing. Then he decided to go and get admitted to Naloka hospital. And while he was walking to the hospital, before he went into the ETU, he collapsed and arrested. And he collapsed and arrested. He was put on a ventilator, but his resuscitation did not work. Nobody ever thought still about dengue, because they thought he got a heart attack. He came with chest pain, abdominal pain, and collapsed and died. So all the reports were sent. He was on a ventilator. He was having AF. After about 1 hours, all the bloods were sent. Full blood count showed 36,000 platelet count. Then only they realized he died. I was called at that time. The physician was also there. And I got O negative uncross match blood. And I just heard about him and gave him, and we gave him a lot of blood, but nothing happened. He did not open his eyes. He died on the ventilator after about 4 to 5 hours. And his wife delivered around the same time that he died. He's 25 years. So that's his story. Then there was a 52-year-old male on the medical ward, one of the other deaths. His son was in the pediatric unit. He was looking after the son, he and his wife. He got dengue in the meantime. Then he went and got admitted in a medical ward. He had no bystander. He had also developed a loose stools. So he continued to have loose stools without a bystander, didn't take any fluid. Wards are full of patients, including about 50 dengue patients. There are no interns these days, only RHOs and I don't know what really happened. He went into shock without anybody's knowledge. Next morning, he was brought to us with his liver enzymes. His liver enzyme has been 11,000 that night. SGOT has been 11,000. Nobody saw the report till morning. And when he was brought, he had no urine output, complete renal shutdown for more than 3 hours. He was sent for dialysis to Ragama, where he died. Then there was this other girl, 11-year-old girl. She got fever and dengue. She is a person who got dengue in 2017. When she got dengue in 2017, this was a time where we had a lot of patients. We were not very, very much willing to admit patients. We were asking people to come only when their platelet count was something 30,000 at that time. So GP treated her. She had the success story of recovering from dengue, probably her first mild infection in 2017. Without having gone to hospital, looking at the full blood counts daily. Therefore, the father thought, if you go to hospital, they will cut you high and saline high and all these things. These are their only child, a very precious child, after being married for 8 years, they had this child. And he was taken to a GP, who was also again a doctor from our hospital. He gave NSAIDs to this child to bring down the fever, and he took it for 2 days, and then on the end of second day he came to us it with liver enzymes up. Her ferritin was 23,000 on this day 3 of fever. We got a bone marrow done that proved HLH also. In addition to her, she had bleeding. We gave her enough blood, factor 7, everything, but within 3.5 days of the onset of fever, she died. So that's third one. Then we had a 36-year-old male. He had recovered from dengue. The moment he recovered from dengue, his monitoring was off. So nobody realized that after he recovered from DHF, 1.5 days later, he has bled. He was suddenly found in shock after finishing almost 1.5 days after he recovered from leaking. And his HB was 6. It was too late to be recovered in the ward. Nobody knew. We did not see him. He was in a medical ward and he died. Then there was a 29-year-old male, one of our hospital employees' son. He was in prison for a drug related offense, and he had aches and pains. They thought he was drug withdrawal, and he was brought to hospital. In the OPD, he died in shock within 2 hours. Then there was this 55-year-old female. She was generally a patient who had, throughout she had her pulse pressures were good. She had good urine output, but of course she is a person who has had a cholecystectomy done, and she was obese, and she had other comorbidities. But she generally did well. From about the third day, for no reason, her liver enzyme started going up. And we were quite puzzled. We gave her blood, though she was actually not PCV was not low. I still like to discuss this case with whoever. Then we found her ferritin to be as high as 231,000, the highest I have ever seen. She, her bone marrow proved HLH just by day 6, and day 7 she died. Then there was another 27-year-old male who is a MLT from a private lab. He got dengue. His wife was, his girlfriend was a nurse from a, another private small hospital. He decided not to go to hospital, take saline at home. And he was managing himself, took saline at home and then came after one day of leaking with a platelet count of 66,000, his 62,000. His brother by force brought him. He also had that damage that he was, we have had patients who, whom we have, we tried to, this kind of patients who come halfway done all kinds of things, but they recover, but he did not recover. His ferritin was 174,000. So that's the all sad stories. If you see, really see the 1, 5 and 27 patients, they almost had shock, died on admission. And then these two patients had again shock, unnoticed shock, and these patients had bleeding. A lot of them, if you really look at, nearly a lot of them had gastric erosions, and they were given at least few doses of NSAIDs at the very beginning of their fever. I was asking, the message that we were telling to the public was paracetamol with arachidone, which is stupid. We have to tell, don't take NSAIDs. I was asking whether we should tell dostarageng anda NSAID dunnada kiyala, but then the minister of health, when he had a meeting, they decided it's not nice to ask the patients to question doctors like that, so we are not asking it. But I think time has come that we should tell the patients that they should ask the doctors when they come with fever whether they are this is that patient, this is the transform, nothing about fever or for suspected dengue, it's all or gastritis. This is this one had postmortem. This is the girl who was given meftal by the GP, and who had so much of bleeding in the stomach. Similar one, the one who treated himself in at home, probably he also took NSAIDs. This is his ferritin. Here, this is another patient who had this. His ferritin was 64,000, but he recovered. We could, he responded to the steroids that we gave. So how to reduce dengue further? I'm suggesting that we should diagnose dengue early. Hasita was telling about the rapid test. I still think rapid test is a useful thing. It is good to know whether you have dengue. Rapid test, if it is done on at the end of day one, is as sensitive as 95%, close to 95%. But what I do is, we had a tradition of asking to do full blood counts on day 3. I normally, because the dengue epidemic is on, when somebody comes to me, I ask them to do at the end of 24 hours, a full blood count, dengue antigen test and a CR, all 3. And then if the dengue antigen is negative, still the full blood count is low, I keep follow up this patient. If full blood count shows signs of possible that 2-5% of patients whose rapid test is going to be negative. But there are other patients whose platelet count is 400,000, whose NS1 will come as positive. So we will not dismiss them as non-dengue because the counts are high. The next day the count will be 200,000. Then during a dengue epidemic, you need to think that any fever could be dengue. Therefore, I think in time to come, we will get this test much more simplified, easy. Within the next 5 years, it will be like the pregnancy test, that you may be able to know whether you have dengue or not through that. This is another example of a similar patient who was asked to do full blood count on day 3, and when he came with a with that, he already had renal shutdown and 35,000. This is another patient who had fever on Friday evening, and she was on a ventilator on Sunday with a AST of 15,000. This happens not commonly, unusual few, but now we'll have to stop the unusual cases. Otherwise, we will not go below the 0.1%. This is another cardiologist's son whose platelet count dropped to 11,000 on day three. On day three, and he had DHF. This is a boy who was sent away from hospital at 18 hours of the onset of fever. He came with a platelet count of 149,000. He was sent away saying that it is too early, and the next day he came with a platelet count of 35,000. So how would this platelet count on day three? I think you will realize. I always think that we should press to make these two tests affordable by making MRP or the maximum retail price and price control for both the dengue antigen test. I sat on tender board for the SBC. The price of the dengue rapid test kits were 530 rupees, 550 rupees, 560 rupees. That's where the labs are earning as much as 3000 rupees. For this, for some reason or the other, I've been shouting the need to bring it down at least 1000 rupees. They'll still get 100% profit because this does not need anything other than a blood drop on it. It's not been done. Same thing for full blood count. The full blood counts are still 700-800 rupees in some places. They can be brought down to, when we were in Pakistan, they put a ceiling. Any lab that is charging more than 90 rupees for the full blood count was sealed by the Pakistani government. So I had to make them more affordable. Then you need to diagnose DHF early. Of course, this is DHF is the ones who are 95% of dengue deaths occur within the DHF. So once the diagnosis is made, you have to make DHF diagnosis as it is said. For that, I think the best is to do ultrasound. We started doing ultrasound in Nigambo, though there are enough literature about ultrasound. I don't think any country is doing the amount of widespread ultrasound that Sri Lanka does. It was difficult. When I started it, many centers, many people refused to use the ultrasound. They send the ultrasound back. Some or other, we showed that because the main problem was people thought that if you miss something, the radiologist thought that if you miss something, that they will be found faulted. Now we got a separate ministerial form that shows the limited ultrasound kind of chest and abdomen that takes only 5 minutes. This is faster than any test. Because if somebody comes to hospital with a platelet count of 100,000, then the first thing that they will have is in our hospital is they will have a scan done at the OPD, at least to know whether this patient is having leaking or not. That is it. But as Ananda said, hematocrits, it is only for diagnosis and to establish the diagnosis, but you need to do serial hematocrits to monitor the patient. Then we need to improve inward care of both dengue and other patients. I remember during the height of the dengue epidemic, what happened to the others? If then they had 250 dengue patients, do you think I was told that the number of other cases, especially in the medical laws, deaths were very high. Nobody took any attention of it. So that is something that we need to look at. I think we need to have the PC use of our hospitals improved to do that. And I was also telling that ministry should develop a rapid group that can sort of go to a place, a team that can go to a place like we did in Kenya in 2017, when there is a breakdown of outbreak of dengue, whether we can send a team, because it is impossible for us to send all the enough doctors, enough trained doctors, enough machines and so on. This is what we did in 2017. Then I just wanted to say that it is necessary that when we have a difficult case, we need to ask somebody. That's the when you have a real difficult case, we have to ask somebody. And also, I think even experts should discuss the more difficult cases that they have come across, the ones who have died, like the case that I told you, with an open mind and explore the truth, ready to change, then only we can stop it happening again. about what you said about anorexia, I'm giving you thoughts. True, the test cannot test whether you are seronegative. But what about so many people? I don't say that we should during the time that the anorexia wanted registration, we were against it because they were going to get it like in Philippines, and our patients are if they get a second infection, they will get severe infection. But it was very well shown that in dengue, you can develop dengue 4 times, and your third infection is usually milder than the second, and the fourth one is even milder. So for those who are definitely had one infection, not serology, you have had dengue. You had NSR positive, you are treated for dengue. We have hundreds of thousands of patients like this. They can benefit by not getting a severe one if they can get the vaccine. So we need to keep an open mind about the vaccine. Maybe even the Takeda vaccine. We used it. I know some of the data that I cannot say it because they are sent it for a publication. During an epidemic time, we don't know what vaccine, how long it will control us. But if a vaccine can give protection for few years, the vaccine may initially be used to control an epidemic, bring down the numbers. The other thing is prevention. I think you will have to stop, not allow a mosquito to bite you. That's the only guaranteed way. None of the epidemiology unit to dengue control unit to other, no unit will do anything that may be that will work. But if you prevent a mosquito from biting you, you will not get dengue. So please take precautions. This is the good example. This girl lost her mother in 2017 epidemic. She got admitted to our ward few days before with the father because she lost her mother now. She got dengue. So after 2017 to 2019, her threat against dengue remains unchanged. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Akuma Fernando. Last presentation is on the lab diagnosis of dengue by Dr. Rohita Muthugala, who is consultant virologist at the Teaching Hospital, Kandy. By the way, this symposium is broadcast today to persons who want to listen to it. So it's been broadcast, and we may get some questions from them also.
Good afternoon to everybody. Thank you very much for SLMA for inviting me for this presentation. After three very interesting presentations, ironically, all three of them were my teachers. I will going to do just a brief outline of laboratory diagnosis of dengue infection. So before starting laboratory diagnosis, I will give a brief overview. What is the basics behind on this laboratory diagnosis? This virus is a RNA virus, which is enveloped, and it is a flavivirus. And this virus is closely related to other flaviviruses, like Japanese encephalitis, Zika, West Nile, and yellow fever. And there are 4 serotypes, dengue 1, 2, and 3, and 4. Now, currently in the central province, especially in Kandy area, more than 80% of the cases are due to dengue 3. I think Dr. Lakkuma Fernando nicely explained now. Dengue 2 occurs in 2017 as a major epidemic. Now, this cross-protection ability has now decreased, and now dengue 3 is appearing. More than 80% is now dengue 3 in central province, and dengue 2 is around 19% like. Just before moving to diagnosis, I will show this natural history of dengue viral infection. After mosquito bite, around 1 to 2 weeks of incubation period, this acute phase starts with fever and the viremia. The virus is usually present around day 5, day 6. Same time, when the viral multiplication occurs, NS1 antigen also produced. This is secretory antigen, and it will last around day 6, day 7. Following that, antibody response will start. Acute one with IgM antibodies around day 3, day 4. Then peak is around day 6, day 7. And this IgM antibodies will last around 50 to 60 days. And IgG response occurs at the same time with IgG M response, it will peak around day 8, day 10, and it will remain lifelong, but it will gradually reduce with the time. So when you are selecting a diagnostic test, the test may be based on the viral detection or antibody detection. The timing is very important. Another unusual thing in dengue, there may be secondary infections. So when primary infection, I have described earlier, then the secondary infection can occur following an exposure to the another serotype. So what's happened here? The viremia is same, NS1 antigen appearance, the same as primary dengue, but in secondary dengue, there is a rapid increase of IgG in the early phase of the illness. So this may be more than 4 to 5 times higher IgG response than primary infection, and the response occurs early within first 5 days. And another thing is IgG response in secondary dengue is very short-lived, and it's not like very intense response. It is very low. So test detecting IgM can be negative in secondary dengue because of this very small peak of IgG and IgM, and the IgG titer will be very high compared to primary infection in secondary infection in early part of the illness. This is the basis of our diagnostic test. So basic diagnostics like WBC, DC, then platelet count and PCV may be the liver enzymes. Then dengue is mainly diagnosed by the clinical features. Apart from this NS1 diagnosis in patients, maybe it's very important to confirm dengue by full virological panel in atypical clinical presentations, patients with some unusual complications, then the postmortem investigation to confirm dengue, and also epidemiological value is there, and also further investigations like characterization of the virus. So what are the diagnostic methods? We use two main diagnostic methods. One is we are looking direct methods. We are looking what are the parts of the virus or virus. The virus isolation is we try to isolate the virus. This is usually a research level two. The other thing is molecular detection. We look for a viral RNA genome and viral antigen NS1. These are direct methods. Then there are indirect methods where we look for our response, our immune response against viral infection, that is detection of IgM antibodies and IgG antibodies. So when and what? Usually, RNA detection and NS1 detection, we have to target in the early phase of the illness. So we are looking for a part of the virus. So it is last only first 5 to 6 days. So if you are looking for a NS1 antigen or RNA detection, we have to test blood in the first 5 days of the patient's illness. If we are looking for an antibody detection, then we have to target the late place. If a patient present in the late place, then we can go for a antibody detection after day 5, day 6. Maybe we can check for IgG levels in early phase in the secondary infection. Moving into RNA detection, it is mainly we are doing by the PCR method. It's highly sensitive, more than 99% sensitive in both primary and secondary dengue, and it is 100% specific. Usually it's recommended in the first 5 days of illness, maybe up to day 7, but it can be positive up to even day 10. But the sensitivity is less after day 5. And the thing we have to remember is PCR tests are expensive. Usually tests cost more than 400,000 rupees. And the availability is limited. Currently available in Medical Research Institute, Teaching Hospital Kandy, Karapiti, and some private hospitals and universities. But this test, we can go for a serotyping, which can give epidemiological value. Moving into NS1 antigen detection, it's usually recommended for first 5 days of the illness, maybe up to day 6, day 7. Even this can be detected up to day 10. In sensitivity in primary infection, it's very good. More than 90 to 95% is sensitive up to day 3. After day 3 to day 5, sensitivity is gradually reduced up to 80 to 85, day 3 to day 5, then the further reduction can be noted up to day 10. But the thing is, in secondary dengue, sensitivity is less compared to primary dengue. I think Dr. Ananda Vijayakrim is one of the patients also, NS1 is negative. It's around 60 to 70%. Because this NS1, we are looking for a viral antigen. And there are rapid rise of the IgG antibody response in our body. Those IgG, some of these IgG against NS1 antigen. So there may be antigen-antibody complexes which cannot be detected by presently available some of the kits. Maybe in future, there may be more sensitive kits. Maybe utilization of NS1 will be very useful, more than now. This NS1 has high specificity. It's more than 98%. There are reports whether it's cross-reacting with Zika virus NS1. And we have detected some false positive results, especially in severe sepsis-like conditions. We have come across 5 to 6 patients in Candy giving false NS1 positives, PCR negative. There are no IgM or IgG seroconversions in these patients with severe sepsis. This can be done by ELISA, which is the gold standard. And there are many rapid kits available in commercial market. Moving into antibody detection, the detection of IgM antibodies, usually after day 5 of the illness. The IgM positivity indicates only evidence of recent infection, because IgM can last 50 to 60 days after following flavivirus infection. And there are strong cross-reactivity among flaviviruses. So this test only gives the serological evidence of recent flaviviral infections. So this can be cross-reacted with Japanese encephalitis or other flaviviruses. So definitive diagnosis need neutralization assay to confirm it. So this can be sensitive, maybe 98%. Sensitivity with specificity of 97%. Moving into detection of IgG antibodies. So this is IgG has more strong cross-reactivity among other flaviviruses. It's indicate there may be exposure to the past infection or maybe due to vaccination. So for confirmation of IgG, we need 2 samples, 7 to 10 days apart. We have to show 4-fold rise to confirm whether this episode is dengue. And in secondary dengue, we can look for IgG levels. If IgG levels theta is more than 1 to 80, we can say this is secondary dengue infection. I think Dr. Hastisera discussed about the dengue vaccine. We have to check for a seropositivity giving it. This is a problem, because this seropositivity may be due to cross-reactivity with other flaviviruses. Especially we are vaccinating against JE, and also we are endemic for Japanese encephalitis. So that may be due to JE. So for available commercial kits, rapid kits and ELISAs will not differentiate whether it is due to dengue, although the manufacturer says. Then we have to go for a neutralization assay, which is more cumbersome, time consuming and need expertise. Then moving on to combination of tests, like NS1, IgM and IgG can improve the sensitivity maybe more than 95%. If it is NS1 negative, but IgM positive in early phase, maybe we have to suspect the secondary infection. This can be confirmed by PCR or IgG levels. And in a gray period, there may be day 4, day 7, like gray period, maybe we can try for a combination of test. For a little bit of a practical problems, some of the commercial kits in the market has very poor sensitivity for NS1 and IgM. Recently, we have evaluated one kit. The sensitivity is less than 20% for NS1 antigen. For NMRA registration and for government tenders, it's extensively evaluated, but I don't know what is available in the small private laboratories. because there are many kits. Maybe 5 years ago, only two or three brands. Now more than 15 brands are circulating. Even they are compete with the local purchase tenders without registration. Then please remember that sensitivity is less for NS1 and IgM in secondary dengue. And there may be technical errors when handling this immunochromatographic test because it should be read within specific time. Maybe a busy laboratory, it's a small scale laboratory, they might read very late, gives false positive results. And antibody cross-reactivity among flaviviruses and this persistency of IgM antibodies 6 to 9 days following infection may cloud the decision making on other infections. Because dengue IgM positive, patient has another infection, but treating clinician, maybe GP might think it is a dengue infection. So a little bit about, again, to refresh you about collection and transport specimens. For NS1 and antibody detection, we need 3 ml of venous blood in a plain tube. It can be kept in a room temperature for 30 minutes just to settle. Then you transport to the lab in room temperature. If any delay, you can keep up to 72 hours in the refrigerator and send it to the laboratory. But for PCR, we need EDTA tube, and it should be transported as soon as possible to the laboratory, at least within 6 hours. So this diagnosis importance in clinical history is very important, because we have limited resources and the cost of test and availability of test. So we need a good clinical history, because most of the time duration of illness is not in the request form. If it is day 4, day 5, day 6, if one test is negative, we can try for another test rather than we are using two strips, because even for a hospital, it is 500 rupees, 1000 rupees. So if it is a duration of illness is there, we can try. Then we can use this laboratory test in an optimal manner, with a cost-effective manner. And same time, if it is better, you can send with the basic investigation results, then the clinical features and the clinical suspicions. Because sometimes the clinicians want to confirm the infection, or sometimes they need to exclude the dengue with their having another priority of these patients. And also post-mortem diagnosis. And also this dengue NS1, IgM and IgG testing is available in the all government hospital above base hospital level, even some DH hospitals, in private sector and certain universities. Dengue PCR is available in MRI, teaching hospital Kandy, Karapitiya, and private laboratories and universities. IgG data also available in MRI and Kandy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Muthukala. We have had 4 excellent presentations, and this is the time for discussion. I'm sorry for allowing you to the seminar to go on more than time, because you are so interesting, I didn't want to stop the speakers. So may I request the speakers to come to the head table? Just want to mention, while they're coming in, that Dr. Aziz Tisara talked about the problems that occurred in the Philippines after the premature use of the vaccine. And for the Vaccine Forum of Sri Lanka annual sessions, we are getting Professor Lulu Bravo, Professor of Pediatrics in the Philippines, to talk about what happened there in the Philippines. She's going to give the keynote address. These sessions are on the 27th of October. Yes. Okay. Yes, please.
All the speakers and of course SLMA also, because this is a very familiar theme, but very well presented and very well dissected into the what are the deep. Rather, I want to actually 2 comments, Dr. Lakkoma and my colleague Dr. Rohit. Last week, I actually requested for my relation dengue NS1 antigen. I don't want to say the private hospital on ethical grounds. It was 2,550. From a well-reputed lab in Colombo, therefore, we will narrow down. Other thing is, of course, a very unfortunate incident of the registration of NMRA files. I think my other biological colleagues are also there. Because we got a file, but my point is actually there should be a regulation on price, at least as Lakomasa mentioned, at least during the epidemic. And the other thing, of course, this particular so-called rapid, or in fact sometimes ELISA, but the rapid kit, we got a file which was re-evaluated. I think my senior colleague did it. It was something like unbelievably 20. Then they coming with another format, they took out this thing, what do you call these strips, and they put it into the very well South Korean particular thing and seal it and sending it. Then again refuse. Then of course they are sending, giving calls from the higher ministry authority, push the file. So I think there should be a very big, these are patient life, as you mentioned. Of course, at the laboratory, golden rule of laboratory is not to treat the reports, but to treat the patient. But there could be sometimes when, you know, as uncomplicated cases, atypical cases, maybe like, you know, shifting. So those are my actually comments rather than questions. Thank you for the opportunity.
Yes, sir. Questions from outside.
Thank you very much, sir. In fact, we have more than 70 participants connected right now, joining on online with us now. So there are several questions. The first question is from Dr. Saranga Sumathipala. The question goes as a question to Dr. Lakumar. Do you do serial ultrasound scans when you look for DHF? If so, how frequently? Thank you.
When you do an ultrasound scan, of course, the typical way the fluid accumulates is that it fluid first appear in say the pericholecystic area, sometimes in the pelvis, Morrison's pouch, and so on. But if you don't see see it progressing, that is over time, if you don't see more fluid accumulating, occasionally it can be due to some other reason. For instance, you can have a little pelvic fluid, very very thin pleural effusion also some. So therefore, it is necessary that we do a second scan after an interval to make sure that there is fluid accumulation to be sure of DHF.
Right. Thank you, sir. The next question is from Dr. Milinda Salpita-Korala. The question goes as, when we ask patients the bite prevention methods practiced at home, they only know about mosquito nets at night and cleaning their surroundings. They have little knowledge on skin repellents, sprays, or are afraid to use due to fear of chemicals. Is it time to start promoting skin repellents, sprays, and vaporizers in our dengue prevention education information?
It's a difficult question to answer in brief. Actually, we have to do more. We have to start from our indoor environments. For example, in Sri Lanka, because of ventilation, we don't seem to have any idea about screening our houses. I think we have to start thinking from the time we enter a premise, we should avoid allowing mosquitoes also to enter that premises with us. That's one of the things that we have to start thinking. We like to put nice fountains and decorate our indoor environment, because we like to see water, but we should not allow mosquitoes also to, you know, thrive in that kind of environment. So there has to be some mechanism, particularly now we are going for high end, you know, these apartments and all that. With all these constructions going on, if we can prevent mosquitoes from entering our premises, that's number one, because that has proven to reduce the number of transmissible mosquitoes inside the houses and wherever living spaces that we have. Yes, getting used to a repellent is important, but unfortunately, same story I have to tell. As far as I know, you can't simply afford the repellents that are available in the market. It's about 500 rupees for a small canister, just a, you know, 100 ml canister is 500 rupees. So for a month, for three kids or two kids, you need 2000 rupees for the repellents alone. If we can bring down and have it in bigger containers and to be used for people, I think they'll have more sales.
And doing so, they can reduce the number of the amount that they can it can cost. Just a little word about Jude's problem about NS1 being 2,700. He's lucky because many of the places I know are selling it at 3,000 rupees. So his relation who got a break for 2,700 for the NS1 is a lucky person, because 3,000 is the average price, Jude, for the NS1.
Yeah. Job. Shall I continue with the online? Yeah. So next, we have two questions from Dr. Jayatri Vijayaratna. The first question goes as, how feasible and when the vaccine would be available for public? That's question one. The question two, what are the brand names of the most sensitive kits for NS1?
Yeah, answer both questions are rejected
as far as vaccine is concerned. I think I'll tell you the background of making that decision so that we are on the same page on this. We'll have to take a consensus decision based on the merit when the dossier is submitted, whichever the manufacturer is, whether it's NIH, whether it's Takeda or Sanofi, we will have to come up with a consensus decision based on the science. So all three vaccines, I mean, these are the live attenuated vaccine candidates who are now in the pipeline of coming as a vaccine. In addition to Sanofi, Takeda is next in line, and then NIH. All three vaccines, because of the complication of the disease, because we are dealing with four viruses. So it's not simple as giving a measles vaccine or a chickenpox vaccine or something like that, because we are dealing with four different viruses and people can get infected multiple times with this virus. So it's very complicated. So we will have to use our wisdom to address this on the merit of the vaccine that is going to be available. And Sanofi vaccine, one thing I would stress, within the first 2 years, we didn't see the complications. Usual period of follow-up is 2 years for a vaccine efficacy trial. I don't know, Jude, is it 2 years or usually do longer? I think it's relatively short, but within 2 years, these complications were not there. We started seeing the complications on the third year. Sanofi vaccines issues came up in the third year. So we need to follow up these vaccine trial participants for at least 5 years to give a sizable answer.
We are on a, Sri Lanka is on a, another vaccine trial. I have been previously on the Asian board for this inactivated vaccine by GSK also, which is now not progressing, almost discontinued. With regard to their only licensed vaccine is the Sanofi vaccine. The second to come looks like the Takeda vaccine. Sri Lanka also participated in a phase 3 trial, which is given to 20,100 subjects at a 2 to 1 active and 1 placebo ratio in 10 countries. Sri Lanka vaccinated 2,100 children. And the vaccine is currently being followed up. In the past 2 years of giving it, it will be for 5 years. But when the vaccine comes, nobody will ever be able to know how long the protection can last, because that probably will have to have, you will have to see. Out of the three vaccines, the NIH vaccine is theoretically more likely to give a longer immunity. But with regard to this, the only licensed vaccine, when it came for registration, we refused to give it registration because we also asked them whether they would like to label it for as a vaccine meant only for people who have had dengue. If you get dengue, you can develop dengue 4 times during your lifetime. It is observed that it is mainly your second infection that is severe. Though we have what you call antibody-dependent enhancement, it is you will not see in most patients the third becoming worse than the second, or the fourth becoming worse than the third. So you will get one, you will get a second one which is very, very severe, and the third one is generally less severe, and the fourth. So what happened with the Sanofi vaccine was, when the Sanofi vaccine was given to patients who have not had, they had flaws in their designing, they never even tested the zero status of this. I am the coordinating principal investigator for this Takeda vaccine here in Sri Lanka. We had a zero status known in all the patients, but whether they are primary or not. Sanofi didn't even know it when they started. Actually, they rushed their vaccine because there were other vaccines they were in the pipeline, and they wanted someone other make more money before everybody else. That happened. So if they were, when normally when you get the second one is severe, when you have no history of dengue, if you get the vaccine will act as your first infection. And when you get natural dengue for the first time, then that becomes a severe dengue, because your first one is second one. It's second because you got the vaccine. Now for those who have had dengue before, when they had the dengue vaccine, your dengue vaccine is your second infection. The most severe one here is not occurring, because what you are giving is a live attenuated virus, because the attenuated virus doesn't produce severely. So when you get another one after the vaccine, then what you get is a less severe one than the third one. So that is how they showed that those who had infections before, they did better. That it prevented severe dengue. I think maybe when it comes to a major epidemic, if you have a lot of patients who have a history of dengue, who knows that they have got dengue, I don't think any test is any test that will, if you want to know whether you have got dengue or not, and if a test shows you have got dengue, I don't think any test will easily be 100% reliable. And if you take a vaccine in that kind of situation, and if you get by any chance, if the test is a false positive, then you are at a risk of getting severe dengue. There were people who went to Singapore to get the vaccine when Sri Lanka did not register the vaccine, the people who had money, that was dangerous. But if you know you have had dengue, because your NS1 is positive, you had dengue, then you know for sure. For such people, I'm sure the Sanofi vaccine can act as their second infection, and it can help by reducing severity in the next.
There's a question from the audience, please. Yeah, Kulitha and somebody else.
So it's a question related to the risk of ICH in patients with thrombocytopenia and dengue hemorrhagic fever. I think in the past, somewhere around 2009 or 2010, when myself and Dr. Veeraman over here looked into these deaths related to dengue, we found there were several patients who had developed ICH, but all those patients were DHF who were badly managed. But since of late, I have come across patients who developed ICH, but all who were managed well. There was no shock or anything during the critical phase, well managed, but severe thrombocytopenia, you are talking of range of something like 14,000 or 15,000, who developed intracerebral hemorrhage. So my question is there a way of predicting the risk of developing ICH in a patient who has developed thrombocytopenia with DHF? And if so, is there an intervention that can prevent the ICH, which is of crucial importance, because once they develop ICH, it's very difficult. Mortality is almost 100%.
In dengue, bleeding is due to many reasons. There's a vascular problem, there's a platelet problem, there's a coagulopathy due to the liver, and many other things. So as a result, platelet is not the only one, because if you have to go by the platelets, when your platelet count is below 25,000, we use IV tranexamic acid for a short period until the counts come up. And we have not had, I would say that we hardly had patients who had ICH. We had patients who had platelet count zero. I had four patients with zero platelet counts for which we did not give platelets.
This is a whole issue because, you know, I have also managed patients with platelet counts as low as 4,000 or 5,000 without any specific interventions and who didn't develop ICH. But then there were patients at 14,000, well-managed DHF, who developed ICH. So it sort of comes out of the blue. Is there a way of preventing that? That is the issue.
I don't think we know of any method of preventing or predicting this at present. I remember about 5 years ago, one pediatric registrar died of an ICH. At that time, when she developed the ICH, her platelet count was 40,000. 40,000. Yeah. So that's the yeah. So with even with minor sort of trauma, or maybe people with some intrinsic things like AV malformation are prone to get. We don't know. I think at present there's nothing we can do prophylactically, but I must say our knowledge and the evidence is not enough. And we had patients with less than zero platelet count, nothing happened without anything. We didn't give anything prophylactically.
Spontaneous hemorrhage at 13,000, and after that only I started using the canisteric acid below 25,000. But that patient also on postmortem, they thought that there may be a AV malformation.
There was a question from there. Anybody? No. Then professor. Oh, yeah, speak.
We know that pros and cons of Dinvaxia, and also we know there are some in pipeline. I just want to know whether we have give up any hope on Dinvaxia, or are we still evaluating it for any context that can be useful, as Dr. Lakuma gave some concepts over it.
It is like this. For Dinvaxia, currently that the vaccine is labeled. There is a label. That is, it is essentially meant only for those who have had dengue. When they first gave us the dossier and when they first introduced it, actually there were many emails that I kept writing to them asking whether they like to change the label 2 years before, which they refused to do. Later they had to do it. Now the vaccine is licensed recently even by the FDA. The licensing clearly says it is only for those who had who was seropositive. So that is for people who have had dengue before. They are in the process of trying to find a test, cheap, easy test that can test that and say. But I personally think for people who have had dengue before, because whatever test that we use, I don't think a test can be 100% when you're going to get a vaccine. That can potentially produce severe dengue if you get it, and if you have not had dengue before, you run a risk. As an individual who is taking the vaccine, you run a risk. Though what is the community risk? Maybe that the test may be 99%, then the 1% can be yourself. But if you have had dengue before, then you know that at that time you underwent dengue and you had a NS1 positive and you had all the features, clinical features of dengue. Then I'm sure you are a candidate for a dengue vaccine that can protect you from a second severe attack, theoretically.
Of the Kumar.
Thank you very much for giving us a very useful overview. First, I will just touch on the question that about the intracranial hemorrhages and hemorrhages. The only way that we can, if you have a very good data set, I am sure that you all have a very good data sets, keep on accumulating the data sets. One way which is currently employed is deep learning and using neural networks to arrive at a diagnosis of, you know, you give the four or five cases, and load all the other cases and layer off neural networks. So I can discuss with you a little later. But I had two questions and one comment before that. How strong is the association or causality of using prednisolone and having some bad outcomes in dengue? Because if you know what is going on in, you know, small OPDs in hospitals, and I work very closely with a hospital that I see patients, and everybody who has fever on the first day gets NSAID, prednisolone, and paracetamol and vitamin B. So we have to have some concrete idea as before. NSAIDs, I assume, but is prednisolone harmful? That is the first question. Second question, PCR. What is the cost of a PCR? My hearing is not very good, but you mentioned
4,500.
Yes. I mean, if you can bring this down, because NS1 is 3,000, might as well bring that down. And that's a second question.
PCR, yeah. You can do PCR. I don't know whether they keep doing it like that. Normal PCR in the private sector. And even in MRI, if you is about 12,000 rupees. But you can do it at without any serotyping. You can do it for about 5,500 rupees in some other private labs. And at Kalaniya University Molecular Biology, that's the place I normally send when we have, say, NS1 negatives whom we are suspecting, is only about 3,000 rupees.
This is exactly, Dr. Lakumar. I had this test about 2 years ago. I was at home and you treated me. The third one is not a very good, not a good question, a comment. I apologize before telling this. I heard quite a few times about GPs prescribing NSAIDs, GPs prescribing prednisolone. I think it is a very inaccurate nomenclature of the medical officer. These are now, Dr. Lakuma, if I may get the example, if your HOs working in pediatric ward.
Let me finish. They are our hospital doctors.
If a pediatric ward HO is there for 5 years, we don't call him a pediatrician. In a surgical ward, if they are practicing in a surgical ward for 5 years, they don't practice surgery outside and call themselves surgeon. So it is completely wrong. These are medical officers who are practicing in the garment sector without any postgraduate qualification in primary care, DFM, MCGP, or MD. They are not, we cannot call them general practitioners. That is the first thing. Don't label, I have had this. I am a very good friend of Dr. Lakuma. He has treated me and we are almost neighbors. But this is a very sad situation. Don't blame this on GPs because general practitioners.
I mentioned our hospital doctors.
Yes.
But I did not, because most of these people, they are medical officers in the morning, GPs in the evening. Okay.
Now we will go back to this question from outside. But before that, now that we have talked about this cost of the NS1 antigen, shall we make a recommendation to SLMA to take it up with the minister that we should reduce it? That SLMA, that out of this meeting, let us as an outcome, shall you tell the SLMA at the next council meeting that we must take it up and say control the price?
As a request, we had a meeting in the ministry. The private sector, the director of private sector health, has been told to bring it down to have a cassette to make the NS1 antigen test 1,000 rupees. I even said it doesn't matter to make it 1,200 rupees because the retail price is sometimes about 800 rupees, and the full blood count to be made 500 rupees.
Good.
There is a thing. But for some reason, it is happening very slowly. So much so, the laboratories, most of these major hospitals, when they want to put a law in the gazette, they readily come and say, no, no need of gazette, we will do it. And when the epidemic is on, for about a month or two, they did it last time. They reduced it to 1,000 And without even telling, after a couple of months, they increased it. So I think I told the private sector director told me, "Okon answer me galasi mo me golang kamo ti una karan." But I said, "Ekat karan na, mekat karan." Puluan lang yasal taka gan.
Okay.
The
elections
are very near, so they will get a very positive thing. So, like the lenses or the stents, can the government import this and distribute it free?
Anyway, let us discuss that. Some more questions before we. I don't mind it going on long as you are ready to wait. I'm ready to wait. Right.
Yeah, a few more questions online. The first question is something related to what was asked by Professor Kumar Mendes. How detrimental is it to use steroids in dengue?
That was asked, no?
I think that's an important question because, as Professor Kumar mentioned, that a lot of patients are getting at OBD levels, especially at private hospitals, steroids. And if you look at those patients, there's no indication to give steroids in the first place. The second place is, second reason, problem is that with steroids, they feel better. The fever temporarily subsides. So often the patients are asked to get a blood test done on the third day if the fever persists. And there's no fever, so they feel better, so they don't get the blood test. And then the third issue is that as a reaction to steroids, their white count and neutrophils tend to go up. So that will mislead the doctor. Instead of neutropenia and lymphocytosis, they will have persistently have neutrophil leukocytosis. That will misguide the doctor also. So these are the problems in addition to possible bleeding, which can occur with steroids.
Just now, I have a patient in Nigambo in our dengue unit, who is a patient who has had a renal transplant, who is on a small dose of prednisolone, 5 milligrams. And I was asked what to do, whether to continue it or stop it. I like to stop it because I don't want to make the dengue any worse. But also, I think that whenever you have a transplant like that, there is natural tendency for it to get rejected. So I don't want the dengue treatment to get blamed for if he has a so therefore, with caution, we are continuing the 5 milligrams of prednisolone, but we are actually looking at her very, very carefully, other than our normal dengue patients, because of this. Yeah. We had a cardiac transplant patient whom we managed with immunosuppressants and steroids some time back. He actually ended up only having DF, who was on anticoagulants as well as immunosuppressants. So there are occasions where they had to do it, but then I don't.
Because in those patients, there are indications for steroids, and which we cannot, which we'll have to continue steroids. But in the most of these other patients, there's no indication for steroids.
The next question is from Dr. Maitri Rupasinghe. The question goes as, for home management and primary care, platelets is taken as the denominator for admission platelet count of 130,000, not other parameters. Why?
That is because the patients tend to have complications generally or almost always when the platelet count goes below 100,000. Almost always. There can be rare exceptions, but almost always that is the thing. So what we generally advise is when it goes close to 100,000 to get admitted. So it may be 130,000, 125,000 or a reducing trend. Say if the patient had the platelet count of 200,000 on the previous day, and this morning if the patient is having 140,000, then of course you'll have to admit that patient because by evening it will drop to less than 100,000. So this is a measurement we can go by, but this is not an absolute indication. We have to take it with the context of the patient, and also we have to see the trend of the platelet drop. And also, in addition to these, there are other warning signs given in the guidelines saying that if these warning signs are positive, then admit, like severe right hypochondrial pain, severe vomiting. So such warning signs are given in the guidelines. So it is, the platelet count is not the only indicator. There are other indications.
So we have only two more questions from online participants. The next question is from Dr. Karunanandan Jeroshan. The question goes as, can we have updated or revised guidelines, especially about blood transfusion and so on?
At the moment, the College of Pediatricians and College of Physicians are in the process of updating the both guidelines.
Good. Next one.
Right. The next question is from Dr. Nadika Pereira. The question goes as, we have made awareness regarding not to take or not to prescribe NSAIDs for fever patients, yet still it is being continued. Shouldn't we take further action?
That's an interesting question. So what shall you do?
I was thinking, most of the people whom we get in our hospital after giving NSAIDs, our own hospital doctors. I was even thinking whether I can put their name in our notice board. Right, but then I asked this, and everybody said not to do that. So that is what we are left with.
I think as maybe the media SLMA can propose to the ministry to take some action if a complaint is made on this, to take some action.
The circular which says,
yeah, that's right.
But actually speaking, I asked the SLMC chairman. It has to be an affidavit. There has to be proof. And proving this case is very difficult. You will have to get the patient relatives. We have got covers like him, where the doctor has written in his own handwriting. But he can tell, I didn't give it this time, I gave it for something else.
But at least having an inquiry will reduce this.
Yeah, I think we should take it up again at the council. I will take it up. Because, we must also have some time, what is happening in the UK, there is a prescribing authority, you know, to look at prescribing that is going on. We don't have it at all.
My suggestion is to ask the patients, to ask the doctor, whenever they go and take treatment for fever, have you given me NSAIDs? That question has to be, the patients has to be educated to tell, to ask that question. Then doctors will.
Yeah, why can't they?
Because most of them do it because of the competition they have among them to prevent them from going to another practitioner for if the fever doesn't come down.
Anything more?
Yeah, just one more question from Dr. Karunanandan Jeroshan. Any place in NAC in liver enzyme derangements as well as DEXA?
For HLH, hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, yes. The treatment is steroids. But NAC, there is no clear indication to give, there are no proper study showing the benefit of NAC. NAC is shown to be effective in non-paracetamol overdose liver disease in adults, not so in children according to literature. So in patients who are very desperate, that is patients who are in very high liver enzymes are dying, sometimes they receive NAC. So they die despite NAC. And there are other patients who are having liver enzymes of only 1,500, which they will recover. They also receive NAC and they recover, whether it is due to NAC or not. We don't know.
Last one.
What about native
papaya?
And what is the recommendation?
I like Ananda and myself to separately answer this question by our own discussion, right? So, I personally think I like to treat dengue the way I know, without adding any unknown stuff into my treatment. Therefore, I advise my patients not to take papaya. But if somebody asks me, what is my personal feeling, whether it works or not, because we see a lot of patients who are taking papaya. I personally don't think it is working, because there are instances where you get more than 3-4 people from the same family coming with dengue. So I even recently had a father who brought papaya to the. So one is about day 5 fever. He was going to give the daughter. I said, don't give to that one, because that one's platelet will anyway rise. give to the day one person and we'll see what happens. And almost every time when you give it to day one person, it drops, the platelet drops. But when you give it to the day five person, the platelet goes up. I think it is, since we do not know about it, and since we know how to manage dengue without papaya, I like to do it that way, without adding anything unknown into my treatment regime.
And they will say,
when my patients ask me whether to take this, but I tell them is, now if you ask whether to take kottamalli, I would say yes, because that we have been taking traditionally, and it's an Ayurvedic treatment, which is an established system. But a lot of people are of the opinion this papaya is also coming from Ayurvedic system, whereas it is not. It had been tried in 1970s in Philippines, where they tried by giving it to rats, where they induced thrombocytopenia by some chemical means and found that the thrombocytopenia improves. So that's how it started. I don't know why they started trying that, but that is where it started. But what he has said, I fully agree with Lakuma, what we see is, some time ago, one of the editors of a newspaper said that they want to do an article on this. So he asked whether to send a journalist. I said, yes. So I asked the journalist to come to the hospital. I took him to the ward and showed some patients and showed him how the platelet went up on day six or seven in the natural. And I told him the natural course. He understood. So he didn't want to have anything, write anything on papaya, but he didn't write anything against papaya also. He didn't do an article. So in most of the, almost all these patients on day seven, it goes up. And it is the day six that people tend to give papaya because that's the time where they get the lowest platelet count. And now in addition to papaya, people have started giving this polos get a tambala. They boil it with the cut up out cover also. And some people I have had who develop severe vomiting and diarrhea.
Okay, then we have had a great session.
Regarding selection of diagnostic kits, rapid kits, the government tenders for government hospitals is extensively evaluated by the virology colleagues and the clinicians like Dr. Lakuma. So the government ones, it's we can't allow less than 20% things to be selected.
Even other ones, I'm both of us are in the NMRA, so these are outside the dengue discussion, but the NMRA will not give calls to clinicians. And if you get any calls asking to give a recommendation, just let us know.
NMRA does not do that. Maybe SPC.